Greetings in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and welcome to St. Albans. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
There is one body and one spirit.
There is one hope of God's call to us.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, who before the passion of your only begotten Son revealed his glory upon the holy mountain, grant to us that we, beholding by faith the light of his countenance, may be strengthened to bear our cross and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for readings from Holy Scripture.
A reading from the second book of Kings. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elisha said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elijah said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing, yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elijah kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. The word of the Lord. Please read responsively by half verse. The Lord, the God of gods, has spoken.
He has called the earth from rising to the sun to this day.
Out of Zion, perfect in its beauty,
God reveals himself in glory.
Our God will come and will not keep silence.
Before him,
he calls the heavens and the earth from above.
To
Gather before me my loyal followers.
Those who made a covenant with me and sealed the sacrifice.
Let the heavens declare the rightness of his cause.
For God himself is judge.
A reading from the second letter of Paul to the people of Corinth. Even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who was talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Today's readings seem to be made for Hollywood. First, we have the story of Elijah and Elisha, and we've got chariots of fire, and we've got partings of waters. And then, of course, on this last Sunday of Epiphany, we always hear some version from the Gospels of the moment of the Transfiguration. It is a bizarre moment in the life and ministry of Jesus and in the experience of those disciples, Peter, James, and John. To remind you of the narrative context here, this today's events happen soon after Jesus proclaims himself to be the one who will be taken up, arrested, and crucified, and raised. It's the first time in Mark's gospel that Jesus tells the disciples what's going to happen. They're headed towards Jerusalem, and he, at this point, explicitly tells them what's coming. Of course, as you remember, Peter said, "That's not what's going to happen. That's not what's supposed to happen to the Messiah." He actually rebukes Jesus. Jesus, in turn, rebukes him, saying, "Get behind me, Satan." Today, we're told that about a week, 6 days or so after that, Jesus takes Peter, James, and John with him up to the top of a mountain. And in that moment, something very bizarre happens. The moment of transfiguration. We're told that suddenly Jesus is transfigured before them. His clothing becomes bright white, such as not even bleach could make it that white. And in that moment, something quite dramatic happens to those disciples. They witness something they have never witnessed before. They have no idea what exactly is happening, what this moment is about. And frankly, we're all left with a lot of questions about what exactly happened, what exactly this moment was about. Why? Why is there heading towards Jerusalem after having told the disciples what's going to happen in Jerusalem? Why does Jesus in this moment take them up a mountain? We don't know. We're not told. What exactly is it that happens on that mountain? I mean, we're given some description of what happens, but do we really know what exactly that moment was like for those disciples? Was it a vision? Was it something literal? What was it? We really don't know. Why in that moment did suddenly Moses and Elijah appear? We can speculate. I mean, it makes sense. Biblical scholars have talked about the fact that Moses and Elijah, they represent the law and the prophets, the Jewish tradition. So perhaps this moment was about a manifestation of Jesus as the continuation and the fulfillment of the law and the prophets. But again, Mark doesn't tell us that. We really don't know. And why did Peter, being very Peter-like, say, well, let's build some tents, some dwellings for you and Moses and Elijah? Now again, we can speculate. Perhaps in that moment, taking from his deeply ingrained Jewish heritage, in which during their time in the wilderness, the Israelites built the so-called tent of meeting, the tabernacle that represented for them God's presence in their midst. Perhaps in this moment, Peter, remembering those stories, remembering that heritage, sees this holy moment and wants to build a tent, a place in which the holy can dwell. And perhaps he's trying to hold on to this moment, to extend the moment. Some have suggested he wanted to just stay on that mountain. But again, none of that is explicitly told us by Mark. We don't know if that's the case, if that's what's going on in Peter's mind. Frankly, there's just a lot that we don't know. And guess what? There was a lot that Peter didn't know. And that's why perhaps he responds in the way that he does. He says, we're told they were terrified. He didn't know what to say. But he's Peter, so he said something. Let's do this. Peter, always wanting to take control of the moment, to act, to do something, to respond. But then, in essence, we're told that this cloud overshadowed him, a voice from heaven, essentially says, shut up and listen. What he really says is, this is my beloved son. Listen to him. To me, this is the heart of the story. Peter's doing Peter things. And in a sense, he's doing things that many of us in that moment probably would do. To do something, to take control of the moment, to act. But the voice says, this is my beloved son. Listen to him. The Greek can be translated here as attend to him. I think it's more than about listening to his words, listening to what he might say, because frankly, in this moment he, on the mountain, he doesn't say anything. In that moment, the disciples, Peter, the one who always wants to act, to take control of the moment, to comprehend what is happening, they're told to listen, to attend, to stop trying to control this moment. Stop acting, doing, and just simply be in the presence of something that is clearly holy. Stop trying to express what is inexpressible, to comprehend what is ultimately incomprehensible, and just receive this gift of God's mysterious, glorious presence. Not easy. Not exactly what most of us have the capacity to do when we're confronted with something that is awesome that calls for wonder, that is incomprehensible. We want to be able to know, to comprehend, to explain. But we're told, as those disciples were, as Peter was in that moment, just stop and listen. Pay attention. Receive this gift. Wonder. It's okay to wonder. It's okay to not know. Wonder and listen. Pay attention. We should probably do that more than most of us do. Amen.
The congregation is invited to be seated, and our service continues on page 301 of the Book of Common Prayer. So everything for this part of the service is in your prayer book. So page 301. The candidate for holy baptism will now be presented. Will you be responsible for seeing that the child you present is brought up in the Christian faith and life?
I do.
I will, with God's help. We're on page 302 now. Here we go. And will you, by your prayers and witness, help this child to grow into the full stature of Christ?
I will.
Do you renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God? Do you renounce the evil powers of this world which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God? Do you renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept Him as your Savior? Do you put your whole trust in His grace and love? Do you promise to follow and obey Him as your Lord? And this next question is for everybody here. We're down at the bottom of page 303 now. Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support this person in her life in Christ?
Yeah.
Let us join with those who are committing themselves to Christ and renew our own baptismal covenant. Now I invite the congregation to rise in body or spirit and turn to page 304. Do you believe in God the Father?
Amen.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the Apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in the prayers? Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
I will, with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
Let us now pray for this person who is to receive the sacrament of new birth.
Deliver them, O Lord, from the way of sin and death.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Open their hearts to your grace and truth.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Fill them with your holy and life-giving spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach them to love others in the power of the Spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Send them into the world and witness to your love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bring them to the fullness of your peace and glory.
Lord, hear our prayer. Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns now and forever. Amen. Amen. Now I will invite the congregation to be seated again, and I am going to get my helper, Wren, to stand up on the stool. There we go. All right, big sister Rin is going to help pour the water in. Got it. Go ahead. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. Over it, the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. Through it, you led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt into the land of promise. In it, your son, Jesus, received the baptism of John and was anointed by the Holy Spirit as the Messiah, the Christ, to lead us through his death and resurrection from the bondage of sin into everlasting life. We thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it, we are buried with Christ in his death. By it, we share in his resurrection. Through it, we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we bring into his fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Now sanctify this water, we pray you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that those who are here cleansed from sin and born again may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Savior. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be all honor, glory, now and forever. Amen. You were such a good helper. Ivy Lockhart, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Ivy Lockhart, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that by water and the Holy Spirit, you have bestowed upon this your servant the forgiveness of sin and have raised her to the new life of grace. Sustain her, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Give her an inquiring and discerning heart, the courage to will and to persevere, a spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all your works. Amen. And now on page 308, let us welcome the newly baptized. We receive you into the household of God, confess the faith of Christ crucified, proclaim his resurrection, and share with us in his eternal priesthood. And Ivy, may the light of Christ shine in you.
There we go. Yeah.
Please rise in body or spirit. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. Good job. Good job. Yeah.
Good morning, St. Albans.
Good morning.
Welcome, everyone. A special welcome to the family and friends of the newest member of the household of God. We're so glad you guys are here, and what a beautiful day. Great job, Ivy, and great job, Ren. So, and also good morning to those who might be new with us this morning. We're delighted to have you here today. St. Albans is a really special, special community, and we look forward to welcoming you. Hope you'll stick around for some coffee and refreshments after the service. And we'd love to show you where the newcomer notebook is. There's a form you can fill out if you'd like to get our newsletter. You can also fill out our online newcomer form instead, which is found by the QR code on the back of your bulletin. But we're so glad you're here and would love to connect with you and share more about St. Albans with you. Also want to say good morning and hello to those who join us online. Glad to see you all. So this morning, I want to say a profound thank you to Carl Plank, who is subbing in for, oh, there's Carl. You moved. Carl is subbing in for John Bailey today, and we're just so blessed by your talents. Last Sunday, you were guiding us through how to talk about Israel and Gaza, and today you are playing the piano and organ, and we are very blessed by you, Carl. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yes. Also, I want to just say, if if you don't see as many teenagers around here today, that is because a lot of them are in the mountains on a ski trip, a youth group ski trip. So prayers for Miss Courtney, she's taken 22 teenagers or youth up to go skiing this weekend. She does have 9 adults with her as well, so that's good. Prayers for our youth group and hope they're having a wonderful time. She sent me some pictures last night and it looked like a great opportunity and experience for our youth. So that's where they are. So today we have a little bit of a task to complete after church. We are gearing up for our Mardi Gras Shrove Tuesday pancake supper, and I hope you all are coming. Every year we got to transform this room into a room for a party. And so if you all are willing to stay after church just a little bit and help move the chairs and set up for the pancake supper, we would very much appreciate your help this morning. So just stick around, and I think Jenny over here will tell us where we're... There's Jenny. Jenny's back there. She'll tell us where she wants things and all of that. So, but thank you. That help would be wonderful this morning. And we look forward to seeing everyone at the pancake supper. That will be Tuesday night, this coming Tuesday night, starting at 5:45. So please join us. We also, of course, this week are celebrating Ash Wednesday. That is on Wednesday, the 14th. We have services at noon and at 7 p.m. I do realize that it is also Valentine's Day, but I really cannot think of anything more romantic than coming to church and contemplating your sins and mortality, right? Priorities. But I do hope you will worship with us if you can on Ash Wednesday. It's always, for me, a very important way to mark the beginning of Lent, and very meaningful way to mark the beginning of Lent. So speaking of Lent, we have some Lenten programming coming up. Starting this week, you will start to get, if you're on our email list, you'll start to get a weekly email that will contain some information about different saints of color in our tradition. One of the things we're doing this Lent is learning more about our history and the history of people of color who have been part of our wider church body, the body of Christ, and who have led exemplary lives. And so we're going to be lifting up their stories this Lent. So I encourage you, when you get that weekly email, to take the time to read those stories. They're incredible. And I thank the members of START who have been helping to do the research and be able to share these saint stories with you. We're also going to be doing a Sunday morning saintly spotlight during Lent. So coming up the next two Sundays after today, the 18th and the 25th, we're going to be spotlighting Polly Murray, who is a North Carolina homegrown saint. And so we're going to be showing some clips from, or some part of some of the documentary about Polly Murray. But if you don't know about Polly Murray, you got to know about Polly Murray. She's incredible. And so we want to tell the story. And so please join us for that. That'll be at in the reflection room at 9:10 the next two Sundays. And so we're also in Lent going to be walking the Stations of the Cross each Friday here in the nave at noon. So I hope you'll find some way to plug into our Lenten programming. The other thing we're doing this year for Lent is we're going to be doing a grief group. So if you are someone who has been struggling with grief, has been experiencing grief, and wants to come and have a community in which to talk about it, express it, I hope you'll join us. We're going to be meeting Wednesdays at 5:30, starting on February 21st, and it'll be for 5 weeks. So you do need to register for that. The link to register is in our newsletter. And then I think that's all my announcements, other than just remember to stay after church and help clear the room and set up for Mardi Gras. Thank you so much in advance for your help with that. Let us now with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor to the Lord. Our service of Holy Eucharist continues on page 367 with a great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Because in Jesus Christ our Lord you have received us as your sons and daughters, made us citizens of your kingdom, and given us the Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with Alban and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. Before the blessing, let me just add one more reminder to stay and help transform the room from worship to Mardi Gras. You've got time. The game does not start until 6. The blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen.
To love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.